when I was growing up, there was no such thing. You know, you had to wait to see a movie on TV or wait to see it in the theater. You couldn't the instant right. access to all of cinema history. You know?
So 82, you're in Northwestern.
Yeah.
And you're thinking screenwriter was like it from the beginning, or
no,
did you have what
no,
you wanted to do?
Never, ever was screenwriter. That I stumbled and fell into the deep end of screenwriting in a completely unexpected way. My passion was playwriting. It's like I went to Northwestern to study theater thinking I wanted to be an actor. Mm-hmm. And looking around the landscape of, you know, the actors who are my contemporaries, like Dennis O'Hare, Laura Linney, Julia Louis-Dreyfus, you see what real actors are, you know, and I knew that wasn't for me, all that... That sort of emotional honesty wasn't my thing.
Les Hendricks.
Okay. Oh, the day. Bob Schneiderman. Yeah. But I took the whole acting sequence anyway that David Downs taught, who's really my mentor, even as an acting teacher, because what we did is you know, Northwestern's approach was very sort of related to classical drama. So we studied. That's where I learned. That's where I read Aristotle for the first time. It's where I read Sophocles and Euripides and Chekhov and Ibsen and Pinter. And I can't, you know, the reason I was there in the first place was Shakespeare, because I fell in love with Shakespeare when I was eight, and it just stayed with me. So it was always the live theater that excited me.
You fell in love with Shakespeare when you were eight.
I did. How'd
that happen?
you might well ask. It's a bizarre thing. It happened because of my father. My parents are from Belfast, so they're Irish, and they were raised with sort of that British sensibility of literature, of poetry, and Dickens, and Shakespeare, and Wordsworth, and that's always been a part of who they are. So when I was eight, we were living in San Pedro, California, and it's like, you know, amongst the Portuguese fishermen, as you do. And my father said one afternoon, come and watch this movie on TV. I didn't want to. He was like, you know, you don't want to watch a movie in the middle of the day with your dad on TV.
Right.
I said, well, what is it? And he said, don't ask. It's got ghosts and a sword fight. And it was Olivier's Hamlet. And that was the day that changed my life, because it was so thrilling to me. And it was scary, and it was mysterious, and it was haunting. And the sword fight at the end is, to my opinion, the best sword fight that's ever been put on screen. I mean, you can look at Richard Lester's Three and Four Musketeers. You can look at you know, all the sort of like Jackie Chan stuff you want. It's the best sword fight ever. So it was touching all those sort of adventuresome buttons that kids love, you know. And yet there was this other thing. It was Shakespeare. And my dad, God love him, started reading Shakespeare with me, all the plays that had sword fights, you know. And then I eventually saw the Olivier Richard III.
So was the language in the way at all for you at that point? Or?
Well, yes, it was, you know, and still is. I mean, it's a different language. You have to like sort of really listen and really work at it. But Shakespeare, the reason we're still reading and watching Shakespeare 400 years later is the drama, the storytelling. And, you know, he is the poet immortal. And that has to do with language and character and triangulation of character and theatricality and plot. And it was the most thrilling thing in the world to me when I was eight, and it's still the most thrilling thing in the world to me.
But you managed to take away all the swords from Coriolanus.
I did. Yes, yes. No, we have some kick-ass knives. We have some serious butchering knives. In fact, we open on a knife, as a matter of fact. We open on our blade.
Yes.
So that was it. It was Shakespeare, and that led me to theater, which led me to Northwestern.
So, I mean, a year like this, actually, we've already spoken to Rafe. We've already spoken to, what's the other one? Now I'm blanking out.
Rango,
yeah. Right. So we talked to Gore the other day.
Yeah.
Who credits you as kind of a true co-conspirator.
Indeed. We were wicked. We were wicked on that one.
It almost like he sees you as like an animator, practically, in the picture. Like he couldn't do it all himself.
Right.
He really wanted to.
Right.
But he needed these, and then you came along and you make his work 10 times better, because he couldn't write it the way you would write it.
Right.
How did that work? How did you get into the middle of that?
It was great, because I've known Gore for a long time, because he came into, I did the remake of The Time Machine for DreamWorks, and he came in to work on that later in the day and sort of filmed the whole sort of third act section of it. And I got to know him that, and I just thought he was great. We really just wanted to do something. So one day we had lunch in LA, and he said, I want to do an animated movie about a lizard. And I said, you know, I'm not going to run away from the table. I'm going to walk away from the table, you know. It's so not for me. But then he started talking about it. And he pitched it as a Don Knotts Western for a lizard. And I translated that, to my mind, to Bob Hope. Because I love Paleface, Son of Paleface. I have an inordinate sort of secret love of many weird things. Ventriloquism, Bob Hope, you know, Danny Kaye, tap dancing. And And so I got really excited talking to Gore. He's just, you know, great filmmakers. What they do is they just go like this. Come on, come on, come on. And then they get you, and then you're in. And it's exactly what Ridley did on Gladiator too. Because when he first brought that up, I was like, you're out of your mind. a sword and sandal epic? No, I don't think so.
And yet you love swords, at least.
I love swords. No, sandals. I love, you know, look, I love the physical expression of adventure. No question. I love a good sword fight. I love a good tap dance. But, you know, so both those projects were, the director was just inspiring to me. And then the process of doing it was, I rarely had as much fun at Rango, because I'd sit in these meetings with Gore Verbinski and Jim Burkett, and we'd sort of hashed out the story together, and it was free form whatever, and this little house in La Cañada. Well, down the hall, there are these animators, like Crash McCready is doing, like, maquettes and drawings, so the characters are sort of coming to life as we're creating them, and, you know, it was a very agile process.
Sounds like being in school again.
It was a little bit being like school. It was, because there was, you know, there was our headmaster was Gore. There were different teachers who had different departments. I was the English teacher, you know. And Gore called me the professor, because they all sort of were crazy artists. And I would come in with my steno pad, my pens all lined up, and my sort of glasses on my face. And I was the grown up in the group.
And Coriolanus was, how did that come about?
Coriolanus was had to do with my just to the marrow love of Shakespeare, and I've always wanted to do a Shakespearean adaptation, because it was Shakespeare movies, not Shakespeare on the stage, that led me into the theater in the first place. And Coriolanus was the one I always wanted to do, because to me, there's something very cinematic about that story. Not only because it's about media and a political figure, you know, and how he's turned, and a war, and, you know, all the sort of flashpoint contemporary connections. I don't think that's what makes it modern. I think it's what makes it modern and cinematic is the central character. Because Coriolanus is so opaque and so complex. He's almost like a postmodern character. He's not sympathetic. He's not the antagonist. He's not the hero. He's not the villain. He's the central character, but he's this unknowable, sort of challenging, aggressive, provocative void, you know, and deeply damaged. It's his damage that I think makes him a very modern character for me. And I always imagine it as a modern movie, you know, with set in our current world, with the absolute sort of hot flash synapse jump media we live in, because that's what Shakespeare was writing about. That was what the Elizabethan political world was. It was very cut and thrust, and that's what he translated to his Roman political world and military world. So our shared agent at CAA, you know, Rafe had gone in to have a meeting with him and said, I really want to do Coriolanus. He said, well, stop right there. You know, you need to talk to John Logan. So I went to
For years you've been saying to your agent, I want to do Coriolanus.
I've been saying it's this crazy thing I want to do. No one's ever going to want to, ever going to want to do it. Because not only is it Shakespeare, and you lose half the room there, it's Coriolanus, and then you lose the other half. Because it's not like you're saying, I want to do Romeo and Juliet.
The Shakespeare that even Shakespeare people hate.
Exactly. You know, Rafe and I will say, the only selling point is the word anus is in the title. That's the only selling point, walking into those studios. But the minute I started talking to Rafe, you know, he pitched me his version of the story, and we were, you know, I did the thing you're never supposed to do, which is I said yes in the room. I was like, done. And I committed, and then we just did it. No one paid us. No one commissioned us. We just did it.
And the movie really works for audiences once they get to it.
Yes, exactly.
Once you get them in the room.
Yeah, once you get them in the room,
they're kind of compelled by the whole idea of the transformation.
And it's you know, I'm most proud of the fact that we managed to capture what makes Shakespeare so compelling to me in a cinematic version. Because what Rafe and I always said going into it was, All we want is for the audience to feel like we feel when we see the play. I mean, you see a production of Coriolanus, I feel I've been assaulted. I feel like I've been punched, and I can barely breathe. And all my corpuscles are a little shaken, and because everything's very dissonant. And we wanted to do an uncompromising movie that had the same effect. And I think that's exactly what we did. I think it's a gut punch of a movie. It's not for everyone, but but for those who are open, I think it's something.
So is Méliès your flawed hero in this movie? Is that or your opaque hero?
No. I think it's Hugo. Yeah.
Well, Hugo is the hero, clearly. Right. But Méliès drives the second half of the movie, really. And he, to me, becomes kind of, I guess, the hero for cinema lovers, for the film goer. How did you approach this whole thing? I mean, you started with the book, obviously.
Right.
But this is a lot more complicated than the book.
It was a challenge from first to last. I mean, it began with just I can't remember if it was Marty or Graham King sent me the book, and this huge package arrived in my mailbox. I'm like, what the hell is this? It's like a War and Peace. I opened it and I started reading the book, and I realized it was half pictures and half text. So you can get through it with great dispatch.
Mm-hmm.
And it really, the reason I did it is because Brian Selznick's book. I think he wrote a masterpiece. It moved me, it touched me, it was mysterious, it was poetic, and I immediately had a connection to it. And it had nothing to do with cinema or silent film, mm-hmm. or, you know, the sort of flash and glimmer, the Baroque Rococo edges of it, the mystery story, the automaton. It had to do with that little boy, you know, because I think what I respond to in material is what's the elemental protean idea, what speaks to me. And what spoke to me in Brian Selznick's book was an orphan finding his way home, and that's, I just said I wanted to tell that story,
which in some ways is Melia's story in this movie as well.
Indeed.
But I mean, do you think Marty was fascinated by one half of the story and you were fascinated by the other half of the story?
No, not at all. Not at all. Interestingly, when Marty and I talked about it, it was always in terms of Hugo. It was all in terms of that character's development. Mm-hmm. And what we talked about, the set of references we used was Dickens. We talked about Little Nell and Little Dorrit. We talked about Oliver Twist and you know, that vast panoply of damaged children who eventually go through adventures, meet the right people, meet the wrong people, but have the grit, you know, to carry through, to earn, to make a home for themselves. They don't fall into it. They make a future for themselves. So all the way, the process of working, and it was a long, hard process, this movie, I won't kid you. We just kept that central. That was the organizing principle. It was all about if the audience is not emotionally involved with that child's face, then it doesn't matter. You know, we referenced the 400 blows, you know, and so everything that came after that, the 3D, Dante Freddy's incredible sets, you know, the score, just, you know, everything was to me completely secondary to the point. The point was it's about that boy, and that's what Marty and I really talked about. Now, having said that, of course, early cinema and the idea of paying homage to sort of our forebears, artistic forebears, was very appealing, and I think, you know, Marty felt some kinship with Méliès, with that, a great artist sort of looking at his legacy, looking at his future, and sort of assessing, you know, where he is and where life and his choices have led him, and you know, it's interesting when, you know, back to Shakespeare, always, you know, to me, there's something Prospero-like about George Méliès and about Marty Scorsese. You know, when I think of the character of Prospero, that the wizard later in his life, an autumnal wizard who still has power and the power to enchant, and how is he going to use it? You know, for as long as he has it, I find very compelling, and that's why the magical element of the movie, you know, the magic tricks that Méliès does, simple card illusions, as well as the huge spectacles of these stages, are so integral to, I think, the sort of thematic and storytelling methodology.
Well, for me, part of it was also that. Particularly seeing it the second time, was how easily it goes away.
Yeah.
You know, how quickly he got lost.
Yeah.
And how, you know, all that passion was still there, and yet he just
felt
he had passed. It was almost like his decision on some level.
Right.
Not to participate in that anymore.
Right. You know, it's easy to make a movie. It's hard to make a career. You know?
Well, did you expect to have this much of a career? Or, I mean, you really expect to have three movies every year now? Or is that your...
No, I never want to have three movies again as long as I live, you know. And if I weren't currently, if the Bond movie wasn't currently filming and I wasn't currently flying back and forth to London and on the set all the time, it might be possible to have this happen. But it's a lot going on. But it's thrilling because you know, as a writer... Mm-hmm. You know, you sit in sort of the chamber of your isolation for most of your life. And then you get to, you know, they open the door and you get to come out for a little while and interact with filmmakers and actors and directors and the sort of the bustling world of cinema or theater. And then you retire back to your cave to do the rest of your job. So what's great about this year for me is it's pulling me out of my cave a little more and allowing me to sort of interact with the great world. And I'm proud of all three of the movies, and I think they're very different.
So how does it work with Marty for you? Are you on set? Do you spend time wandering on and off? Or
no, I was on set a bit, just really to visit. We you know, both my two experiences with Marty on The Aviator and then in Hugo, the script was in pretty solid shape when we started shooting. Mm-hmm. So you know, I would come and visit, and the process of working with Marty is always is very very straightforward. It's mm-hmm. I would do a draft, he would respond to it, do notes, we'd work back and forth on sort of shaping the material as the movie was evolving, as it was going, because both those movies eventually went into production. Mm-hmm. So then the realities of production begin to influence the script, and it sort of becomes that living organism back and forth between on the page, the artistry of the creative team, and the physical reality of filmmaking.
But he's really getting the script pretty much locked down before he actually starts shooting.
For the most part.
There's not a lot of playing around on that.
Not a lot of play, especially with a movie this big. It's very hard to play around with a movie this big. You know, it doesn't move with great agility because it's a big one.
So what was the hardest trick on this particular piece for you?
Yeah, well, it was all hard in a way. I think
well, there's so many things going on at the same, you know, it's
there's so many I think it was keeping the central story central. Because it's easy to become distracted with other elements. It's easy to say, oh, this is a movie where it's going to be about the sort of the flash and panache of 3D, mm-hmm. or the opulence and spectacle nature of Paris in 1931. You know, and when you have incredible actors like Sir Ben Kingsley and Sacha Baron Cohen, Asa Butterfield and Chloe Moritz and Jude Law, you know, you want to write for all of them. You want to give stories to all of them, make it feel like a fully lived-in world. You want the movie to fit mm-hmm. like an old coat, you know. So the challenge for me always was keeping the central mystery central, which is, what is the message from his father that he is compelled to find out? Why is he compelled to find it out? Mm-hmm. And when he does, how is it going to lead him to the place he needs to be?
Well, that is one of the other elements is the Tati-esque characters in the train station.
Right.
Which do feel, I mean, it seems like yet another world inside of this world.
Yeah.
Was that something that just naturally evolved because you needed something for him to play off of? Or?
No, it was a very conscious decision because you know, as a writer, I'm just drawn to, I think, the subcultures, you know, whether mm-hmm. it's the football team in Any Given Sunday or the engineers in The Aviator, you know, and I thought that was the world inside the studio, because it's almost, you know, inside the train station, excuse mm-hmm. me, is almost hermetically sealed, because Hugo very rarely leaves it.
But
and
it is like a studio in a way. I mean,
it is very much like a studio.
The slip is actually pretty
exactly.
Freudian, because it does, when he leaves, it really feels like he's leaving his box, his place.
Yes, he's leaving his safe bound, where he knows all the... You know, and you know, because of what he has to go through and sort of the adventuresome nature of the story, you have to establish a place where he's safe and he knows the way it works. He can mm-hmm. literally go behind the walls into the workings of the place. But when he leaves that, he's going into this void where there's snow falling and it's cold and he's unprepared for it and anything mm-hmm. could happen. And it's the anything that could happen mm-hmm. that makes movies, you know. So inside the station, you know, I just knew I wanted to populate it with a really fascinating world of people he gets to interact with, all of whom teach him little sort of bounce off of him, like Alice in Wonderland. You know, mm-hmm. the caterpillar leads her to the March Hare, to the Red Queen, and Brian Selznick did a lot of that in his book. But we mm-hmm. wanted to sort of flesh it out more, and you know, we talked a lot about Rear Window. We talked about mm-hmm. those little vignettes you get of life in Rear Window. We wanted mm-hmm. to get the vignettes of life in the station as well.
Well, the romance of the two puppies.
Yeah, of course.
And the two, I mean, it's such a speed change, and it's such a, you know, emotional change, and it reaches, I think it touches a different swath of people in a different way.
Right.
It's kind of fascinating, because it's dangerous, I think, in some level. Mm. You know, you have a Tom and Jerry thing going on between him and Sasha's character.
Right.
And then you have this very, very sweet, gentle adult thing going on at the same time.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, that sort of variety, I think, makes big movies interesting, mm-hmm. you know, because it's not tonally austere. There's mm-hmm. there's a world where you can have a Keystone Cop-esque wild chase up and down stairs, through trains, over trains, and then within the same universe, you can have an autumnal love story of two old people trying to you know, having their brief encounter again with dachshunds. It's all of it. If the muscularity of the piece supports it, uh-huh. I feel like bring it all on, because I don't like uniformity of tone when it becomes oppressive, because then it becomes liberating, and you get it. It's just bad dramaturgical work, because the audience mm-hmm. is, I believe, they're going to be excited by changes, by shifts in tempo, not by a you know, when you set your car on cruise control, you stop driving. You know, I mean, who wants to be on 55 their entire life going down the highway in Nebraska?
So how critical is the girl? I mean, and how difficult is that to make work as well as you made it work?
Well, I mean, Isabel is she's the co-star of the movie as far as I'm concerned. She's she's the co-lead. I think, you know, Méliès is like the wizard in The Wizard of Oz, or the witch in The Wizard of Oz.
Or
but,
both.
But, or both at the same time.
Yeah.
And but I think Isabel and Hugo are like Dorothy and the Scarecrow. I think they're sort of the bonding element. And and I'm particularly proud of the work I did on the character of Isabel, because there's a great problem that needed to be solved in Brian's book, which works beautifully in a book. And it's magnificent that when you get to the end of the book, you realize, oh, this entire story has been written by the automaton. That's part of the storytelling methodology of a book, because you are holding the book in your hands. Well, you can't hold a movie in your hands. So how do you get some resonance of that? And when I was working on the scene where Isabel and Hugo are in the clock tower and they talk about purpose, you know, I thought it was, you know, it's very poignant that they're both orphans and they're both wondering what their purpose is. And he has a little better sense of it. And she doesn't. But the fact that she could end up being the person telling this story, I found sort of interesting. So I sort of worked backwards from that idea and just thought, what if she's a woman a girl who loves reading, who loves books? And that's in Brian Selznick's novel. I was just able to bring it out to a character who loves the sound of language, the riff from, you know, when she gets to say the word clandestine, you know, there's a little spark in her eyes. And Chloe Moret seized on every one of those words like a terrier, you know, just really enjoyed.
And if it, when Hugo has a word that...
Yes, that impresses her.
That impresses her,
she's like, well done, you know. And so to me, it made a really sort of lovely, rich character. And also as a writer, it's paying homage to the written word and to the sound of language. So I just love Isabel in this.
It's funny because I hadn't thought of it quite like that, but now that I'm thinking about the movie as you're talking about it, I think all the characters really have those moments where whatever it is that makes them happy, what turns them on, when they see it in somebody else or they see it happening, they all seem to blossom.
Yeah.
And every character in the movie really has a moment where they blossom.
Yeah.
And I was thinking particularly about the Mrs. Méliès' character.
Yes, yes.
And how she can't help but to look at her at the film again. You know, it's just the love of it, the passion for it is.
Or the station inspector that Sasha plays. Because in the book he's a smaller character and doesn't have as much of a personal, you know, arc. But once you set your protagonist as Hugo, you need an antagonist who balances a little bit. You know, it's the old sort of Bond, Blofeld, Holmes, Moriarty. You know, you need that sort of binary pull. So from the very first discussions, Marty and I talked and Graham talked about bringing the station inspector up. But then once you've made that character, you have to make him as multidimensional as all the other characters. So the idea that he too could have a little love story, that you could see his heart warming up a little bit as Hugo's warms up, as Méliès warms up a lot, you know, that you could see the sunrise on all those characters was lovely and gives it sort of a dramatic unity.
Well, he reflects Hugo ultimately. I mean, it was interesting because seeing it a second time, a lot of those subtleties become more apparent because the first time you're so busy kind of breathing in the 3D and all the visuals and all the, you know, there's so much going on in so many different ways.
Believe me.
That, this, you know, you have to kind of let the movie breathe to see everything.
Right.
But he really seems to reflect Hugo, though he never gives him a break.
Right, no.
Still.
No. Well, he does at the end. He does at the end because that's the moment where the station inspector could hold on to Hugo's collar and take him away to the orphanage, and that's the end of the story, and you have a very different ending. But there's the moment that Hugo's breaking down. He's holding the sort of broken automaton, like the shattered remnants of his life in his hands. He looks up at the station inspector and says, "You should understand, because there's a man who with sort of an artificial leg who's trying to sort of fit into the world." And you see the station inspector's face just melt. You see a softness come into him, and he releases him to go to Méliès.
There was a shot of the girl, though.
Yeah.
I feel like she's the one telling. I mean, at that moment, she kind of.
Well, it's a challenge.
She's the heart of him.
It's a challenge to him to say, "Are you going to be? Are you going to prove yourself to be the kind of man I can love?"
Yeah.
And he does. Thank goodness, because it's a happy ending.
So when it all comes together, and you've been on the set a couple times, obviously wrote every word of it. Does it surprise you when you see the pieces all put together?
It does. It always surprises me. Because as a writer, you have a certain image in your head, you know, and you sort of, it sounds a certain way in your head, and then you mm-hmm. see it on the set, and it becomes a different thing, because it becomes a living act between actors and a director and a production designer and the world they're living in, mm-hmm. and then finally, when you see it in its finished form, that's the iteration you wanted. And it, you know, sometimes it doesn't live up to your expectations in a strange way, and sometimes mm-hmm. it vastly exceeds them. And those are the times that you cherish. You look back and you say, I had no idea it could be this, you know? And that's why what we do is collaborate with other artists. And mm-hmm. they bring their best, you bring your best, and hopefully those become interdigitated. And you can give something to the audience that is everyone working on all cylinders. And that's what I think Hugo is. I think Hugo is a lot of artists working to their best form, challenging each other to go that much further, to go beyond their comfort zone. You know, Hugo for me is a much more emotional movie than perhaps normally I would write. So I was pushed a little bit into my comfort zone of thinking about my own relationship with my father and family and life, you know, and I think we all did that for each other. And although I'm sure everyone's been saying this to you, talk about it, there was something special walking on that set. You felt that, yeah, it's a big movie. It's a big Hollywood movie, no question. Mm-hmm. But I've been involved with a lot of big Hollywood movies, and I have never had the feeling as I did walking onto the Hugo set of kinship, of trying to do something just that much different.
Do you think part of that was having had a relationship with Marty and having...
Yeah, partly because I was so comfortable with him, and The Aviator was such a splendid experience for me, and I enjoyed every second of it. So certainly the ease of interaction with Marty and the way he runs a set and interacts with, you know, because it was pretty much the same crew from The Aviator to Hugo. There was a comfort level and a shorthand in dealing with things, but it was more than that. It had something to do with this subject, this topic, and really, quite honestly, it all comes down to Brian Selznick. You know, he made this book from nothing called The Adventure of Hugo Cabret, and all of us were inspired by that and wanted to preserve something really delicate and unique in that, in our form, you know.
And what do you think it is with Marty? I mean, he's not a kid. He's still doing new things every time out. It seems like he's pushing himself harder now than he was when he was, you know, 40 or 30 or whatever.
I think that's how prosperous day is a magician. You try new things. You conjure new storms. You know, if every time you look over the ocean from your island, you say, I'm going to create a storm, and you raise your wand, and lightning strikes a certain way, you know, that's not creation. Mm. But to try something different, to say, I'm going to make a sea monster, you know, or I'm going to bring the clouds over my head, you know, I think that's what gives artists a career as opposed to a movie or a job. You know, and if you know, when Gore Verbinski sits down and says, let's do an animated movie about a lizard, or Ralph Fiennes says, all right, do you really want to do Coriolanus and you want to do it hard and mean? Or when Sam Mendes says, come do Bond. You know, it's those challenges of things you've never done before that keep me every day getting up and sort of running to the keyboard.
Hard for people to do, though. I mean, people do get caught in that rut, and Hollywood seems to want to keep everybody kind of doing the same thing they've done 300 times.
Well, if you let them, you know, but I don't. I mean, it's. I think it's, for me, it's, I always feel I'm here sort of, I'm sort of sneaking in, because I feel myself a playwright, and my background is in playwriting, and I'm most comfortable on stage in the theater. And I, you know, I fell into Any Given Sunday with no preparation whatsoever. So to me, I feel a little bit sort of like, wow, look at this weird world that I know nothing about. And I'm still sort of playing around in. So it's always very playful in my response to I might take it very seriously, obviously, you know. But there's still something fantastical about it. Whereas the theater to me is the bedrock reality of you're in the trenches making drama.
Mm-hmm. Slight difference between Any Given Sunday and Hugo, I think.
Slightly. Yeah, or like I say, you know, people say, like, so why did you do this movie? Why did you do Hugo? Mm-hmm. And, you know, I always talk about what I said to you. It's like, I was inspired by the book. I'm inspired by the orphan. You know, any chance to work with Marty Scorsese, I'm going to do. If he says, let's film the phone book, I'll be like, let's start with A and go, and we'll find it. We'll find the movie, you know. Mm-hmm. But it's also, you know, I have a 10-year-old niece who's never been able to see any of my movies until this year. So you know, to be able to say, come see Rango, mm-hmm. and then come see Hugo, was sort of very, very fulfilling because she couldn't really come see Sweeney Todd, you know, or Last Samurai.
Just parts of it.
Yeah, just parts of it, like 20 seconds of it.
That's right. She could be an orphan with selling pies.
Yeah.
And is every filmmaker part of that adventure, is having the variation between a Tim Burton and a Marty Scorsese?
Always. Yeah, my great attraction to movies is film directors, and always have been, you know. Mm. And that's what excites me the most, you know. And whether you're sitting with Oliver Stone talking about football and watching game footage, or you're walking through London with Tim Burton thinking about alleys and opium dens, it's thrilling to see.
Oliver was thinking about opium dens. Yeah.
But it is you know, it's exciting. It's exciting to have another artist who sort of pushes against you and raises your game. And you know, I never want to work with a director who doesn't challenge me, who isn't better than I am. You know, who doesn't know the work of drama. You know, but they're all different. You know, they all speak their own language, and you have to learn the language, and it's always a slightly different language or a vastly different language.
Now we know why you work so much.
Yeah,
because you're actually listening to them. Well, you're sure, actually yeah. doing. You're. It sounds like you're Matt, just engaged it's like and alive.
Great dramatists are great cannibals, and it's like the ideas that come, you lean forward when the idea comes because you know, I can use that, I can turn that can become something. And at the end of the day, it's still going to say written by John Logan, you know. Mm. So it's that the sort of the pulsing give and take between artists, and whether directors or producers or you know, lighting designers or grips or actors, it really doesn't matter. It's we're all engaging in the same subject, and you never know who's going to have that sort of like that shard of an idea that's going to lead itself into a great line or a great scene or a great story.